Next on Enviro Close-Up, David Phillips of Earth Island Institute. Welcome to Enviro Close-Up. I am Carl Grossman with David Phillips. He's the Executive Director of the Earth Island Institute. Earth Island Institute was founded in 1982 by David Brower, and I interviewed David Brower, who became its chairman. I interviewed him in 1996, and he said, "We've trashed the planet quite successfully." Dave Phillips, let me ask you right off, how has Earth Island Institute been doing in, well, so to speak, untrashing the planet? Now it's 40 years.
Thanks, Carl. It's great to be here and very happy to talk with you about that. It's been a long 40 years in trying to unravel some of these trashings, trying to think about the organizational way that we're set up that really helps us do that. And for that, I think we have to like roll the clock back to 1982. Dave Brower had been the executive director of the Sierra Club for 27 years. Really the most amazing visionary and monumental leader, taking over the founding from the founding of Sierra Club by John Muir, and actually really becoming the creator of the modern environmental activist environmental movement. So that was kind of in our DNA. When he took over after that, after he left the Sierra Club, he did a dozen years at Friends of the Earth, where he was also sort of broadening the scope of what really even meant by environmentalism. At the Sierra Club, it was started as an outings club, and really was morphed into a political activist organization that worked on things like stopping the damming of Grand Canyon and setting up national parks and ways of getting people involved in different ways. And that transcended to Friends of the Earth, where it was actually broadened even further to lots of international work. But David Brower was always looking for something new and always looking for something better and different. And Earth Island became that insofar as what Dave was looking for and what he felt the environmental movement needed was a place where individuals, like one person or a small group of people with a good idea, could find a home and a place where they could try to turn this into actual accomplishments for protecting the environment. That really didn't exist at places that were becoming sort of more bureaucratized. And so he was looking for small. He was looking for bold. One of his favorite quotes was from the writer Goethe, who said about boldness, he said, "Whatever you can do, begin it. Boldness has genius, power, and magic in it." That was one of Dave Brower's favorite quotes. And it really became sort of the motto for Earth Island. How we could try with small numbers of people with great ideas to have an organization that would help do the work behind the scenes in terms of administrative work and things to help keep the organization legal, et cetera, and give time for those people to get out and do their program work under this umbrella, under this accelerator model that would help them synergize with each other and go on and do incredible things. That was the theory. We didn't really know whether it was gonna work. But in 1982, after our founding, we started with a number of small projects that were just getting going at that time, some of which became big. So we had the Rainforest Action Network, which went on to become its own 501c3 and still is doing great things. At the time, it was more David and Goliath type things, trying to work to protect the world's rainforests and finding ways of looking at things like how eating meat and Burger King were involved with things of trashing the rainforest and engaging in consumer actions to undo that trashing.
Dave, tell us about the rescue of these poor dolphins.
Our International Marine Mammal Project had amongst our first major victories when it looked at, after the Whaling Commission had put in place a moratorium just beginning in 1982 and not taking place until 1986, took on right in our backyards the largest killing of marine mammals in the world by the US tuna industry. And it was just a small number of people taking on this multi-billion dollar consumer tuna industry that was using a practice of setting nets intentionally around the schools of dolphins. Because of that, they were formed mixed schools with the tuna, and they could catch the tuna and the dolphins and then try to let some of the dolphins go, but keep the tuna. And this was happening in a huge area of the Eastern Tropical Pacific. And a small group at Earth Island under the International Marine Mammal Project took that on with some real strong tactics of consumer boycott against that, bringing in the kids to not eat tuna and have it taken off their menus at schools. And there was a volunteer named Sam Labuddy who actually had been out on boats and got a job as a cook on a vessel and brought back this incredible footage, the first time ever footage showing what was really happening there in a way that pulled back the curtain like never before. And this ended up being shown to Congress. It ended up being part of a lawsuit that we had against the government. And in the end analysis, we ended up overturning the tuna industry's use of this fishing technique, resulting in a reduction in this mortality from over 70 to 100,000 per year down to by 95% reduction. So this was a huge victory enabled by just a small number of people with a great idea and great dedication and untrashing the dolphins by having consumers and the public hear about these things and take action. That's the kind of thing that Earth Island has specialized in, trying to, again, find these a place to support great ideas. And that actually came from Dave's efforts when he would travel around the country, speaking to college campuses, talking to people about revving them up, getting them involved. And he'd end his speech by saying, who would be willing to like donate a year of their life to trying to save the world? And the hands would just shoot up. And it was just an incredibly inspirational way to get people involved. And I know that because I was one of those people. I was one of the ones that was recruited in that fashion when I was in school and just getting ready to graduate from college in Colorado. And that drew me right out and into Earth Island. So the model that we have is a different one than the regular model of an environmental organization. It's an organization that builds all the infrastructure and helps the projects do what they're able to do and their strength, and not have to do all the things of filing the 990 forms and the 501c3 status and get them out working, get them out producing, get them out making, doing the things that they can contribute to protecting the environment. So that was a real turning point for Dave Brower. It became his last real organization, the one he stuck with, the one that and that went on until his passing in the year 2000. So we had that 18 years with Dave Brower, and in that time we went from 1, 2, 3 projects up to a dozen, 2 dozen, 3 dozen projects, and those are now, we have now 40 years later, to speed it up to the present for a moment, we now have 75 projects around the world doing phenomenal work to address the unprecedented challenges to saving the planet. And they're in the, going back to your metaphor, they're doing the untrashing. They're confronting very difficult obstacles with small groups and effective and inspired action. And that's been sort of the way Earth Island operates. And we've never had more projects. We've never had stronger projects. It's turned into a model that really works in the modern day, because it was prescient at the time for him to think of it that way, because what really now is the case is that all the efforts necessary to be legal as a 501c3 and filings and all the filings that have to be done are so voluminous, so much more now than they were then. And to have 75 projects not have to do that, not have to reinvent 75 board of directors and 75 audits and 75 insurance companies, 75 offices, you know, it's just all things that really help them put their work into the thing that they're passionate about. So that's a bit of of the beginnings of us. And it's really comes back to that focus on boldness, that focus on what Dave saw in his visionary capacity about a different way to set up an organization that could really get the job done and really make a difference. And so that's where we got our start.
Yeah, I should note too that it's on the website of Earth Island Institute that it gets its name from Margaret Mead, the famous anthropologist. She urged respect for the island Earth, and there becomes Earth Island Institute. And also Margaret Mead, who actually in print, not on TV, I interviewed, a marvelous woman, said, and this is also on the Earth Island Institute's website, this famous quote, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has." However, Earth Island Institute it's big. I mean, it's all over the place with many battles, many, many victories as well. Maybe you can speak about some of these other, great victories that Earth Island has done and has achieved in its 40 years.
Yeah, thanks. There have been lots of projects and lots of activities on various fronts. And some of them are large, some of them are still small, some of them have grown very large. And so some of them that might come to mind, I will also say that we did something that was really important for Dave, and that was in our core program around focusing on youth. And so I wanna start there because the Brower Youth Awards, named after, of course, Dave Brower, started a little bit later, and it became the premier celebration and acknowledgement reward award program for youth from 13 to 21. These are kids that have incredible ideas and have started activist environmental programs to accomplish them. And so for more than 22 years now, with more than 135 winners, these are folks that have come through our program, have been mentored, taught, have chances to synergize, and we celebrate them by doing videos about their work and showing the work that they do. And in some cases, their work ends up back at Earth Island as a project. So we've had a winner, May Bouvier, who is now the executive director of one of the largest climate protection organizations, 350.org, was a Brower Youth Award winner. So we're growing the next generation of environmental leaders. And by doing so, that's really helping make a difference. Others, we have a winner that, recent winner that is with a program called Herbicide Free Campuses that took on the effort to try to ban the use of pesticides and chemicals on the lawns and gardens and fields and at University of California at Berkeley, and has been incredibly successful, including getting that extended now to all the campuses in the regions of California. So it's getting a wider reach, and now started a program at Earth Island to try to expand that to other campuses everywhere in the country. And it just makes sense that you have, you know, students and others lying down right in the middle of fields that are sprayed with Roundup and that are just toxic and dangerous and cancer causing. And so again, a project that some years of Brower Youth Award winner that had a project was recognized, that has gone on to become a leader, and now is doing that as a project of Earth Island. So that would be another example. of something, and clearly the Brower Youth Awards is one of our premier things. We're doing it every year. This October we're doing it again. It'd be the kind of thing if people could sign up for and find out about. They can watch it in person if they're in Berkeley, California, and also see it an online version that comes in October every year. So that would be an example of really ways that youth was seen as so important to us.
If you just joined us now, we're speaking to Dave Phillips, Executive Director of the Earth Island Institute. Please continue, Dave.
So now, if you look at another project that we have that we're really excited about, we have the Plastics Pollution Coalition. This is a LA-based effort to take on the incredible scourge of plastics in our oceans, in our rivers flowing into the oceans, the single-use plastic, but also the plastic that's just being dumped at sea. And this coalition that they manage now has more than 1,600 organizations in it in 75 countries. They're working to do things including having legislation to ban single-use practices in the U.S. Congress that's actually moving, which is amazing considering how locked up things are on most fronts. Also getting the UN to have a treaty about banning uses of plastics and requiring bioplastics and alternatives to these things. So they're a project that's grown really fast and is doing extremely well. We have another project. We have projects that are working on. Another example would be that started really small and is growing very fast is a project called Green Schoolyards, especially in California, but really nationwide now. Like the schools have paved areas for kids to play, playgrounds. These asphalt playgrounds, as the global warming hits this world, are getting hotter and hotter and hotter to the point that in California and in the West, they can't even go outside. It's too hot. It's 100 degrees. It's 20 degrees higher on the schoolyards than it is in the air because of the radiant heating from asphalt. And this project is about trying to have the building of shaded areas, shaded places for gardens and lawns and or places where the kids can be outside and actually learn outside and do outside learning about nature and the environment and science, and have it in a protected area where there's vegetation and trees and shade. And this has been a great project that's been picked up now by the state of California. It's being expanded. It's recognizing the real need to do something about this, and it's just blossoming. So that again would be sort of another one of these ones that it just came from a great idea of an individual, and it's now manifesting in statewide and even nationwide ramifications. We've got a lot of projects working on wildlife, the Project Coyote, trying to end these killing contests where the coyotes are, where there's actually incentives in many, many states to give money for people to go out and kill coyotes. And instead, this project is working on ways of recognizing that coyotes are part of the environment, trying to figure out ways to share the environment with them and to prevent these wholesale killings. So we do a lot of work on that. And so these are kind of indicative of it. If you go to our website, you can scroll down and see a number of these projects and learn about them. And actually people can get involved if they can connect up. There are some of them that have petitions that could be signed or that have things that you can do to get involved. And it's really educational just to see the breadth of these projects and what they're doing. So those would be a couple of them. We could go into some more if we have time to. And it really has been amazing how much they're able to accomplish.
Now, Earth Island Institute is based in Berkeley, California, rather than like a lot of the major environmental organizations And Earth Island is a major environmental organization in Washington, D.C. Is this an advantage to be away from the Beltway in Washington and be in Berkeley?
I think it is. I really think it is. And I think Dave Brower found that out in some of his interactions where we're really, even in the Friends of the Earth days, there was a lot of tension between sort of the congressional agenda and the Friends of the Earth agenda, and how it mixed, and whether all decisions there really were the ones that made a difference or whether things have to happen elsewhere. In the now, to be honest, there is so little happening in Washington, D.C. that influences the efforts to protect the world environment. It's so polarized, it's so locked up, it's so slow moving that the real efforts are happening in many cases through consumer action and through individual action. So for example, or in many cases through state action, but it's not happening to a great extent in Washington. And so for things like climate change and things like plastic pollution, there's more happening through individuals changing their buying practices. The companies know that they have protection, that they're not, that it's going to be very difficult to change that through legislation. But consumers are rising up and saying, I don't want to buy these products anymore. Single-use products, one, every plastic bottle being thrown away, most of them not recycled. Now thought the most accurate indications are about 90% of the recyclable plastic isn't even being recycled. People are putting it in their recycling bins thinking that it's being recycled, but it's not. In many cases, it's shredded and landfilled or exported or burned, incinerated. So the more people find out about it, the more they're putting the pressure. We have a lawsuit that we've filed through Earth Island Advocates against the plastic, the largest, worst polluting plastics company, Pepsi, Coca-Cola, Procter & Gamble, about the fact that they're using fraudulent business practices. They're deceiving people into thinking that it's recycled when it's not, that their claims of sustainability when it's not, when really this is causing harm to the environment. And we've sued them in California. We got a very recent decision, literally in the last few weeks, as the companies have all, and we sued 17 countries, their companies, and they're all gathering together to fight it in court. And they've tried to get it dismissed, saying that, oh, well, we're not located there, and California is just one state, but that's not. And the courts ruled in our favor that, yes, those companies are liable to have this brought in California, to have them have to reveal what they're doing and what harm they're creating, and take responsibility for it. So the courts are becoming more important. The consumer actions are becoming more important. And unfortunately, DC isn't really the place for where most of that is happening. The other thing is, we built the David Brower Center in Berkeley, California. It's our home, and it's an amazing place. It's the greenest building. It's one of the top green buildings in the state of California. It's solar powered. It's got free circulation of air. It's LEED Platinum. It's the highest level of LEED Platinum for any building. And it is a place that's sort of the home for the environmental movement. It's got a theater and galleries, conference space, organic restaurant, and room for a number of environmental organizations and nonprofit organizations to be resident there and not subject to like all the boom and crash of the rental market. So we are anchored there as our headquarter office, which doesn't mean that we don't have projects that have offices in other places all around the country, but our headquarter is in Berkeley and we're very happy. And we'd love to have people come out and see it and visit us there. And you can also see online about some of the features of the David Brower Center. So we're not moving to Washington, D.C. anytime soon, that's for sure.
Now, you're a biologist, David, and your expertise, your specialization is in the preservation of marine life. And you've been active, indeed, in Earth Island Institute on that issue. You, among other things, you direct Earth Island's International Marine Mammal Project. Speaking of victories, a rather noted victory from a few years ago that you led involved the Free Willy, how do you pronounce it, Keiko?
Yes.
Talk about how that battle was won.
We did take on this incredible effort to try to rescue and release the first captive orca in the world, and an animal that had been made famous in a Warner Brothers movie, Free Willy. And the whale there was still captive in this small, shallow pool. And we had to go through incredible Herculean efforts to bring him to a rescue center that we built and bring him back to his home waters in Iceland, where he came from. An amazing odyssey fueled by the love of kids. And one of our great accomplishments and really an amazing effort. So that's a short version of how we saved the whale Keiko, the made famous in the movie Free Willy. So it was an amazing effort. It still makes me just amazed that we were able to pull it off.
Dave, how could people get involved with all the activities of Earth Island Institute? They could go to your website, but perhaps you can guide them in their involvement with your organization.
Yeah, so, the world is facing such unprecedented threats right now. It just is such a time for people needing to step up in so many ways. And we're just hoping that people will find ways to connect with some of the things that we're doing, join our network, get our newsletter, get the Earth Island Journal, which we put out quarterly. If you have some great idea, submit it and think about whether or not we'll explore with you whether or not it could potentially become a project. Take actions as consumers to really hold companies accountable for what's happening to the environment. Get involved, get out in nature, celebrate the splendor of our world. And because that provides an amazing it provides the fuel to keep us going. Dave Brower used to say, save the world by having fun. Otherwise, you're just going to depress yourself. So it's got to be made fun. It's got to be made part of people's lives. And we're happy to do that and help people connect. And would love to have them come and see what we're doing and see how they can step up with us.
Thank you so much, David. Dave Brower, looking down, would smile with the accomplishments of this organization that he launched, of which you now are the executive director. Thanks so much for being with us on Enviro Close-Up, and thank you for the work you do and Earth Island Institute does.
Thank you for having me, and thanks for covering Dave Brower's work back when you first did that. You've got the great history and timeline of it all, and very happy to participate with your work, Carl.
Thanks again, and thanks everybody for watching Enviro Close-Up. I'm Carl Grossman.